like to call the January 21st school committee meeting back to order. Thanks for your patience. We now would like to call the public hearing in session. So if there's any public regarding the FY 17 budget. So is there anyone that would like to speak to that?
Members of the school committee, Superintendent Doherty, Assistant Superintendent Martin, Ms. Seibert, Ms. Wilson, I'd like to thank you for allowing the public to address you tonight and to voice their concerns. I would like to address you, the committee, tonight on the cuts that pertain to the Latin department at the high school. The Latin department at the high school provides students with a cutting-edge, unique opportunity to learn a non-mainstream language. It allows students to explore culture and language that has been around before even Jesus Christ was born. That being said, with the help from a little basic math, Latin has been around for over 2,000 years. Spanish, French, and even the language I'm communicating with you tonight in English have all stemmed from Latin. In fact, half of our English language is made up of Latin words or roots. The study of Latin indisputably expands one's vocabulary and understanding of challenging words. For example, the Latin word pater means father. From the word father, we have two words, fatherly and fatherhood. But from the Latin word pater, we have patriarch, paternal, and 12 others. Simply, Latin teaches kids more words and expands their vocabulary, a skill I think everyone in Reading would value in their education. Latin teaches English better than English teaches English. Classicus Charles Bonnet said, "The study of one's own language is achieved incomparably better by the indirect method of studying another language. It is because translation from Latin to English is so helpful to the student who would attain mastery of his own language that I find the full justification for the study of Latin. In other words, education based on the study of a child's own language is inferior to one based on Latin." And now to explore the college benefit of Latin in high school. Aside from Latin students obtaining a remarkably higher verbal SAT score compared to Spanish students, many deans of admissions from prestigious colleges and universities around the world have said that Latin on a transcript stands out to them. William Fitzsimmons, Harvard's Dean of Undergraduate Admissions and Financial Aid, says, "Because so few students these days master Latin, it can help an applicant. We certainly take notice. A Latin student 40 years ago would have excited us. Such a student today is of even greater." Who had taken Latin throughout high school. We ended up offering the student admission, and I think it is fair to say that it was the commitment to Latin that tipped the scales. Learning Latin requires abstract thinking and hard work, and colleges certainly know this. When asked what he thinks when he sees Latin on a high school transcript, Vice President for Enrollment at the University of Chicago, Michael Bennick, said, "This student is likely to be disciplined, have a strong basis for further learning, and be a little bit more creative towards intellectual pursuits than most." Latin is an amazing language. By cutting Latin at classes at the high school, you are not only stunting the educational growth of Reading students, but you are cheating many out of their potential. Reading students deserve the best. Give them the best. It is indisputable that Latin can only provide nothing but good things for students. Rerotest non quam perit, the truth never perishes. Latin did not fall with Rome, so don't let it fall in Reading. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. I'm proud of you. That was nice. And I suspect that there's others that want to speak to that as well. And I just like to say that Alex made a nice presentation the other night, as did Mrs. Mahoney, who was here. So we have been thinking about this since our last meeting, and I know Dr. Daugherty had, I'd like to actually, if that's all right with the public that wanted to speak to this, I'd like to ask him to speak at some ideas that we have or that he's put together to try and answer and answer your questions and concerns.
So
that's
thank
all
you.
Right with the rest of them.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I didn't find any money that would pay for the cuts that I presented to you, so I apologize for that. However, I have been meeting with Mr. Barker over the last few days concerning the, because we have 3.4 FTEs being reduced at the high school, for those of you that may not know that. One of it was for the Latin teacher. What we're going to do is the one that was designated primarily for the Latin teacher, instead of saying it is for primarily Latin, it is going to be a cut of FTEs across departments instead of dedicated just to Latin. We're going to base those cuts on course selections that are going to be happening over the next couple of months. What it means is that there'll be some sections that may not happen this year, and it may be something that gets offered every couple of years in different departments depending on the course and the enrollment of those courses. It may not mean we have two full-time Latin teachers. It could mean that we have 1.4 or 1.6, but the idea is that the sections that are available have substantial enrollment so that students can take the classes that are, you know, are available to them. So it's not any reduction in the FTEs that I'm proposing. It's still going to be 3.4, but we're going to look at the 1.0 that was assigned to the Latin a little bit differently.
So we'll discuss that as we deliberate the budget on Monday night and do our best. But I also know that many of you came prepared with statements as well as Chris, as if you're welcome to come up, and we'd love to hear it. So
can I just make a follow-up
sure.
question to that? So if after the budget, if it passes or whatnot, and course selection and course enrollment in Latin, in the Honors Latin program and Latin studies, if that is high, would the budget then be reevaluated to increase funding for?
The school committee votes, I'm going to give you a real quick budget primer here. The school committee votes on a number that then goes to the town manager. The town manager, based on what the town can afford, either keeps that number, reduces that number. I don't think he would be able to increase that number in this year's situation. And so he then creates what's called the town manager's budget, which is both for town services and for the school department. That budget then goes to the finance committee. And then the finance committee will be asking questions of all the departments. We will have to present to the finance committee. They are the advisory board to town meeting. And then they will take a vote on each of the departments, which the school department is one of those departments. And then town meeting has the final say in the budget. And the town meeting votes on the bottom line of the school department budget. They don't vote on, you know, let's add a teacher. They vote on increasing the bottom line or decreasing the bottom line,
right,
or keeping the bottom line the same.
Okay.
So we're going to be basing our cuts on what the needs are of the high school.
Currently, and that.
No, the next year's course enrollment. So right now you're in the process going through your course selections, or you will be over the next month or so. So the FTEs that we reduce in the different departments is going to depend on what courses have low enrollment. So we're going to take a look at those things. So by the time they vote on the budget next week, we're not going to have that information.
Right.
What they're voting on is a number.
Okay. So like you said, there's very minimal possibility that it does increase. So the budget does increase thereafter. So thus, like, wouldn't the course selection and enrollment not really matter then?
Well,
no, because there's so many FTEs of teachers that the budget is supporting.
Full-time equivalents.
Full-time equivalents, yeah.
Okay.
So if the, you know, if the enrollment, after that's done and the enrollment says that, you know, we need X number so that nobody gets turned away from Latin, that money will be shifted that way so that it doesn't happen, right?
Right.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, maybe this is not a time, but I mean, I think we look overall at enrollment, and when I think about it, I think the issue is if the enrollment says there's, you know, two full classes and then five students, and I don't know what that number would be, we need to look at, can we increase the two sections and put those five students in there? Because we won't be able to say we can have a class and have a low enrollment,
right,
but we have 20 kids that want an engineering section and we can't do it, or we have 20 kids that want a photography and we're going to try to do that. So that's up to Dr. Daugherty and Adam Barker and the staff, but they won't be able to get any more money. They won't be able to say, well, the numbers tell us we should fund this photography section, but we've got these six students who we just can't fit, you know, we have 29 desks in a classroom and that's what we've done. They won't be able to say, well, we'll get you another half of an FTE and we'll create another section. That just can't happen once the budget, you know, once we vote on the number. So.
Come on up, sure.
Solway.
Hello. I don't have too much to say because I think Chris covered most of what we're all thinking. But I'd like to submit this petition signed by 105 students over the five sections of Latin from all four grades to keep Latin. And should I submit this too?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm not sure. Sign in.
Hi there. My name is Melanie, and I'm a senior. And I just want to speak to the benefit of Ms. Irons and of Ms. Mahoney. All 4 years in high school, I've never had two teachers who are more passionate about what they do. And I think getting rid of them would be a huge mistake or anything like that. I personally, every day, look forward to coming to Latin class because I'm always greeted with a smile from Ms. Irons. I've had her for 2 years, my junior and senior year. And I've had Ms. Mahoney for my freshman and sophomore year. Every morning I sit in Ms. Mahoney's room before homeroom, and I do my homework on a chair in her room, and she'll talk to me, and we'll talk about Latin, we'll talk about our lives, and it's such a nice feeling to have a personal connection with the teacher. It really makes you appreciate and understand what's going on within the school and appreciate like the things that they're passionate about and what they teach. Ms. Irons is my homeroom teacher, so I've known her for 4 years as well. She's such an understanding person, and every single time, like, I ever need to do something, I need to go to guidance to see someone, she always lets me do what I need to do. And she's just very understanding. When I sit in Latin class, she always has a smile on her face, and she always talks and laughs about what we're learning. It's so important to me to just have a teacher who really loves what they do, because it lets you kind of understand, like, it's more important to teach something and learn something that you want to learn about than of a class that you don't necessarily have to take. So getting rid of, like, so the language requirement is for 2 years, and I've decided to take four. And I think that when you decide to take 4 years of a language, it gets harder and harder. And the fact that students keep wanting to take Latin, keep wanting to take Latin three and continue to Latin four, it's really important to honor that, because if you try to get rid of Latin studies, or if you try to get rid of Latin 3 and 4, then you're stripping students of a chance that they make to want to better themselves. And it's kind of a blow to their self-confidence.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jackie. And I just want to touch upon the fact that this is kind of bigger than us. It's not just us. Like, we're all pretty much in Latin 3 and 4. But the other day, my sister told me she wanted to take Latin, and I was stuck in a tough place of telling her, like, you know, take it or don't, because, you know, we don't know where we stand yet. and I don't want to encourage her to take something that limits her to 2 years of language instead of 4. So it's, you know, bigger than us, and it's everybody, not just us.
Thank you.
Waiting for you, Patrick.
Good evening, school committee. My name is Tim O'Sullivan. I'm the junior class president of Reading Memorial High School. I'm going to be very brief here. I don't really have much to say. But coming out of eighth grade, coming out of middle school, I will be the first to tell you that English was my least favorite subject by a long shot. I was happy to scrape by Mr. Olivo's eighth grade class with a B minus in the class, getting absolutely thrilled whenever I saw anything higher than that on my paper. And ever since I've started taking Latin, English has slowly and slowly, slowly improved for me. Coming out of eighth grade, I believe I had low proficiency on my MCAS scores for English, and I just got my previous MCAS scores for sophomore year back in the mail over the summer, and I believe I'm actually past the threshold of advance now through the about in the middle, and I think that Latin had a very large part to do with that, both with the grammar and the vocabulary. It has helped me quite a lot in other subjects as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
I would just like to thank, no, please come up. Please come up. While you're walking up, I just wanted to thank you all for coming and for your passion. And my son took Latin as well, and I know how important it is. And I think that you have made us all very, very proud. Thank you. Sorry.
Hi, I'm Nancy Irons, and I teach Latin here at Reading High School. I guess things have changed a little since I prepared this speech, but I'll just go ahead and talk about, you know, the classes that seem to be endangered. So I spent 15 years developing the strong Latin program that we have here at the high school. And I think our program is impressive just for the scope and breadth of the offerings that we give our students. If you look at the numbers of the students enrolled in Latin, you might think like, oh, Latin has fewer students than Spanish or French. And you might see small class sizes, but part of the reason that we have smaller class sizes is that we offer many different levels of Latin. So students are placed in a class that is just right for them. And I take pride in the fact that I teach many different types of students. The Latin students you see here tonight are some of the brightest, most motivated kids in our school. They're capable of reading Latin literature in my honors class. I also teach 3 sections of Latin Studies 1, which is essentially a special education class. And it offers the Latin 1 curriculum over 2 years. Many of the Latin studies kids have never had the chance to take a foreign language, and now they're finding success. They're in a class that's just right for them. So I'm not sure what would happen to future students if Latin Studies 1 is not offered anymore. I'm not sure how those kids would get the 2 years of foreign language that they need to graduate. I think that they would not be absorbed easily into Spanish, and I really think that they would get lost. I know that they won't get the class they deserve. So as for all my students who want to take honors Latin next year, I think they deserve the chance to finish the 4 years of Latin that they've committed to. I don't want to write in anyone's college recommendation next year that, you know, a senior couldn't take Latin 4 because the class is canceled. So I hope that Reading is always a place where academics come first. Lately, our school has offered more and more electives for students to choose from. They have a lot of classes they can choose from. So I would say that Latin is the original, most classic of classes. So I urge you to preserve it.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Carla Nazaro. I have 4 children in this school system. 2 of my children are currently taking Latin at the high school, and I have an 8th grader coming up who would like to take Latin. Just thinking back, we moved here 11 years ago. We moved to Reading because of the school system. My husband and I grew up in one of the top school systems in the state. And I actually took Latin in middle school. In elementary school, I took French. And in at the high school, I took Italian and Spanish. So for me to think that we only have two language offerings in our high school is disheartening. I know this is not the forum, but it's time for an override. Our school system just not going in the direction that I hope that it would be going in. The money's not there, and we just can't keep cutting. If it's not Latin, it's going to be something else. We just can't keep cutting. We need to invest in our school systems, in our children, and in our town. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hello, members of the school committee. I'm also a parent, not of a Latin student. Full disclosure, however, I am a Latin teacher. And some of you are well aware that Latin was dropped from the American curriculum for decades and has made an amazing revival. The number one foreign language teacher of the year for 2016 is a Latin teacher and is from Massachusetts, teaching at a public high school. Does anyone know who that is or where? It's Dr. Ted Zarrow in Westwood. And there's a waiting list, and they can't fit all the kids in there. Latin is not considered outside of foreign languages. It's moved into them, and there's this whole spoken Latin movement that I think your teachers are participating in also. I find it sad to think of eliminating the upper division classes, because colleges want to see usually at least 3 years of a foreign language. We have a two-year requirement. They like four. This is what I was taught and advised when I was on the faculty at Austin Prep in the middle school teaching Latin. I looked up a few numbers. They're a couple years out of date, but from a Boston Globe article about 4 years ago, there were about 20,000 students in 126 of the school districts in the state taking Latin. This was about 6% of all students taking language classes that were taking Latin. So that's tiny. Why not just drop it? Why not just eliminate it everywhere? Schools set themselves apart by keeping it in the curriculum. Reading has set itself apart by building a strong program. What a shame to dismantle it, because it will take years to come back, years and years, if it's decided later, oh, gee, that was a mistake, or wow, we should have put some funding towards that. I think 15 years to develop what we have now speaks to the commitment, the time, and effort involved in building something that used to be a cornerstone of the American education system. So I hope Reading won't water things down and decrease the academic offerings, which are for everyone, but we'll try to pull a rabbit out of a hat and try to find some dollars in other places. I think this would be a big mistake.
Thank you. Anyone else? Is there any other talk? Yes, come on up.
Hi. My name is Claire Walsh. I've been in the Latin program since my freshman year. This year I'm taking Honors Latin 4, which is the highest level offered at our school, along with teaching all her other sections of Latin. Ms. Irons has generously lent her own free time to teach me AP Latin this year. It's not a course that's normally offered at the high school, So I take it as an independent study. She gives up her own free block to teach me. I think that the fact that there was another student last year who she also taught this course to, it shows that there's been continued interest in expanding the Latin program, and now we're considering shortening it. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. It's our program is really special, and there's people who want to continue it as well as people who join it just because they don't have any other options, like students in Latin studies who wouldn't be able to take a foreign language if Latin studies didn't exist. That's really important to keep. And I feel like if we were to cut that away from our school, it would be taking something huge away from our school. There's not a lot of teachers that would stretch themselves as thinly as Ms. Irons does for her students. That's important to honor.
Thank you.
I see something here.
Sure.
So last week you all heard me talk, and so they're all talking like logically why you should save Latin and about how much they love it. And as I said last week, I just want to point out again how much I love it and how much I can't express in words how much I value it and how important it is to me. And honestly, I think it's kind of ironic that Mr. Scarpito left last year, and he took Latin in college as well. So I feel like it wouldn't have happened if he hadn't retired. So that's just something I wanted to point out.
Yes.
Sorry, I forgot something. I would also like to mention that because of my involvement with this Latin program in high school, I'm going to be studying Latin next year when I go to college. I just applied to a scholarship at Holy Cross called the Beeman Fitzgerald Scholarship, which is a full tuition scholarship for Latin students. There, and that's Holy Cross has like a really professional Latin program that's very highly valued, and I think it's important to consider that I feel that I would be at home there coming from this Latin program.
Thank you. Anyone else? Is there any other aspects of the budget? Yes, come on.
Hi, my name is Anson Hong. Disclosure, I don't take Latin.
Okay.
I'm a French student, and I have been for the past 4 years, but it doesn't take a Latin student to see the cultural and historical and academic significance of having a Latin program, a good Latin program here in Reading. My sister, Melissa, she took Spanish during middle school and continued it through high school, but after the second year of high school, she just wasn't really feeling it. She could have dropped out then. She could have moved on. But instead, she switched to Latin, where she had Miss Irons, and she decided she loved it. So today, she graduated last year, and now she studies at Brandeis University, where she's thinking of having a linguistics major. So I think you all should know that having a Latin program can really affect our students' lives and send them into the future knowing what they want to do.
Thank you. Any other aspect of the budget that anyone wants to discuss in, excuse me, in the public hearing?
I just have questions.
Can you mind coming up? Or?
Oh, okay. There are specific questions. Do you want me to wait until after the presentation?
It's on the public hearing on the budget.
Okay. Right. I mean, we may not have the answers for you tonight.
Oh, okay. I just had specific questions.
Yeah.
In terms of looking at Nancy Doctor, by the way, and in terms of looking at the cuts for regular teacher day, I was looking actually at some of the positions that were added on last fall, and I wanted to know if those are actually being cut also, or if they're staying in the budget. The registration coordinator for extended day, the billing specialist for extended day, both of those, I think, salaries were quoted at 45, 55K for both of those. And then the grant analysts. That was funding, I thought, that was supposed to be split between the operating budget and a future grant. So I wanted to know if those were actually staying or if they were being cut.
The first two positions are not in the operating budget. Those are come out of the extended day revolving account. So they are not part of the budget that we're talking about.
So those are actually
support the extended day program.
Right.
Which is not in our budget.
So that is
the grant writer is out of the school transformation grant and is not part of this budget either. So cutting those positions would not have an effect on this budget.
So then the other question I also had, because that was a piece, is about a year or so ago, there was also a position for, I don't know what it's really called, the facilitator coordinator, that is to help actually rent out the school property to kind of get some more revenue. I think that was a position that you added. It was about a $30,000 position that was put under
It's a 0.6 position.
Okay. And I know that there's a fair amount of revenue that the school department then generates from renting out school buildings, which is a really wonderful thing. Prior to that position, is there a number that you had of how much income was generated prior to that position?
That's a question we'll have to get back to you on.
Okay, so that was a question to see whether or not, because that was a $30,000 position. I didn't know how much
but
it actually
I don't believe
generated.
That position.
A portion of that position is funded from the operating budget, and a portion of it is funded from the revolving fund, so it's split between the two.
Okay.
So
and that revolving fund now funds the town core and school facilities. So it's
okay.
It's a it goes across town and schools now.
Okay. And then the other question is really to the school department is whether or not anyone from the school department actually contacted the Beverly school system or the contact from HES about looking at vendoring with the mental health center for an in-house program.
You mean members of the school committee? I did.
No, it wasn't the school committee that was going to look into it. It was us that was going to look into it, and we did actually look into it.
Yeah, and we've been working and talking with Riverside as well.
Okay.
But that's not going to result in any savings to the school budget.
No, it would be an expansion.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's what I was really looking at, an expansion.
We do use outside services now for counseling in the district.
Right, as opposed to, but this was a very different program. Mm-hmm. It was an in-house. So that's what I wanted to do as a follow-up. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
Good evening. I'm Leah Barton, and I have a daughter in the elementary school system. I apologize that I haven't been actively involved in these meetings, and I'm getting here late to the party. I see that you're voting on Monday. But what is the plan to correct the deficit? I think I speak for many parents in expressing concern about the shortfall. Raising property taxes.
Well, there was a financial forum last night where there was a broad discussion about the town's finances and potentially needing a Proposition 2.5 override in the very near future. We kind of left the meeting feeling like we needed to focus on getting this budget done and then jumping right into those discussions in the next few weeks, and that will continue into the spring and some early summer. And some of the consensus, and it was just discussion last night. There were no votes or anything taken, but some of that discussion was around potentially doing something and in terms of a ballot question in the fall.
Okay. Thank you.
Is that that?
Yep.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just want to add that there were quite a few people there that appeared to be very energized about stepping up and seeing what it is we need to do in the community, in this community, to pass an override. Because we don't do that very often, because it was 13 years ago. So you might reach out to some of the networks and try to connect with some of the people that were there last night.
That's good to know. Yeah, I do have a list of contacts, and I think parents do want to get involved and help support the effort. We're not here just to criticize. It's,
sure.
We want to be collaborative and help out, whether it's at the PTO level or
through, you know, galvanizing support for an override if needed. So thank you
for that.
I believe the presentation from last night is on the town website.
Thank you.
Which may help answer some questions also.
Thanks, John.
Thanks. John's too? Is it both?
I'm going to get that on there.
Oh, okay.
Thanks for pointing that out.
Thank you.
Yes?
RCTV actually said that it was taped live, so hopefully it will be on quickly. So YouTube and on broadcast on the stations.
Great.
As well.
Town manager's and presentation is already on YouTube on RCTV.
Can I just reiterate
something
that was said at the meeting? That part of what we need to do is what you were talking about, which is educate people that no question is a bad question, that there's lots of research that has been done, and the more people know and the more people understand what we're grappling with, that there aren't any magic wands, there aren't any pools of money waiting somewhere, the more people will understand what needs to start happening in terms of an override . Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay, seeing none, I will close. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
My name is Nick Boyd, and I have two kids in the school system here, in elementary school, and a third one on the way. I'm one of the budget parents, and I've listened to John's presentation a couple times. The only thing I'm not a Latin student. I did not take Latin. My mom forced me to take Latin, and fortunately, I didn't have teachers that were as good as them. I would say that to think carefully before cutting teacher time, whether it's elementary school or high school, as a parent of kids in school. I see a difference with my kids depending on the student-teacher ratios in the classroom. They're not on IEPs, they're not in 504s, they're just part of the pack. When there's, across the board, when there's more teachers available for the kids, my kids benefit from that. And I've seen that over the years here in Reading. There's a lot of passionate people here. What I'm hearing here isn't just about Latin. It's about an academic experience and a learning experience. And when you talk about all the problems that schools have managing, the difficulties of growing up, we've heard from a lot of kids that are really benefiting in a positive way from an academic experience. And whether it's, if I hear that, I almost don't care whether it's Latin or photography or I don't care what it is. If I hear kids and committed teachers having an experience that is helping them succeed in the future and allowing teachers to pass on their training and abilities to those students, I would think really hard about cutting that when it's 1% of your budget. You have a $45 million budget. If you add up all the FTEs that we're cutting, John, forgive me if I'm wrong on this, but my impression was that we're under 5 million or under 500,000 for all the cuts in FTEs that we're doing.
For the personnel piece of the
personnel
cuts.
Correct. Right. So you're talking about 1% of a $45 million budget, and you can't find that somewhere else? Think carefully, because when those people walk out the door and the kids don't enroll and they don't have these experiences, they're going to find something else to do. Okay? And you're not going to, I don't know if you're going to get the teachers back or not, but this is the front lines. This is where students interact with teachers. If you're going to save your 1% here in exchange for losing 3-some FTEs here, we haven't even talked about the elementary school where my kids are going to lose next year. Okay? So just think about that, whether there's another way to restructure debt or other ways that, I don't know what the scope of what's on and off the table here, but just in terms of the money you have. If you're trying to make a point to get an override, this wouldn't be the way to do it, just if we want about it. But my strong feeling is I would be very careful about cutting teachers thinking that it's just something you can fix next year. There's some damage you can't undo. That's it. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Anyone else? Yes? Melon? Yeah, because the TV won't be able to hear you.
I just want to add something real quick about the whole photography has been brought up a lot as an example. I'm in AP photography. So our teacher handpicks the students that she wants in the class because there is such a great number of kids who want to take it. But I absolutely do not think that you should cut an art class over a more language-based or mathematic class. I think it's so much more important to have some sort of class that gives you prior knowledge into history, prior knowledge into things that you can use to help you make decisions in the future. I love photography, I want to continue it in college, but I also want to be a teacher. And Ms. Irons and Ms. Mahoney are the reason that I do want to be a teacher. So I just want to let you know that being in an AP art class, I still believe that language is far more important.
Thank you. Okay, we'll close the public hearing and maybe just take a 2-minute recess so that people want to leave.
I'm gonna stay, I think.
So, I wanted to ask you, since I heard your
comments. Probably not.
I happen to have a list of vacancies that are open for town meeting.
I told you you were gonna get sent in.
That you live in?
week.
Thank you.
No, you don't have a do you have a report?
No, I don't have a report.
No.
He beat the over under.
And you?
Yeah, John, you beat the over under.
Which was uneventful.
Oh, I'm glad we took a break. It was nice to stretch.
I know. Okay, but wait again.
No, I get home at like 10:40.
Sorry.
Whenever it's kids, all rules that are off.
He doesn't want to go to
I'd like to call the meeting back to order, and I didn't mention at the beginning of the meeting, this meeting is being televised live with RCTV. At this point, we'd have public input, if there's any other, with not something that's not on the agenda tonight, and reports. Alex and Carl, you have? Or Alex, and then Carl, I should say.
So this week, the juniors have been doing real-world problem solving. So we've been working since Tuesday with topics. My topic is natural disaster relief. Other groups have surveillance. There's something about oceans, just like stopping illegal downloading, stuff like that. So tomorrow we are presenting in the field house all the work that we've done this week. Also, on February 5th, 6th, and 7th, on the 5th and 6th at 7:30 and 2 o'clock on the 7th is the Drama Club's production of Around the World in 80 Days. So they've been putting in a lot of hard work, and they'd really appreciate it if people would support them.
Thank you. Carl.
So this week, midterm week, it's really not that stressful. I don't find that many of my peers are too stressed out. It's very doable. Some progressive happenings at RMHS. We have a gender neutral bathroom on the third floor, and the Mr. RMHS competition is now the Mr. and Miss RMHS competition, so females can't compete. Other than that, I don't think I've reported for a while, so I don't think I reported on the Super Bowl. We lost at Gillette, but great experience. Winter sports have started. I know the hockey games, boys and girls, are Wednesday and Saturdays, and the boys and girls basketball teams have games on Tuesdays and Fridays, so anyone wants to attend those, that's about it.
Thanks.
Just really quickly, to add to that, of course, I don't have the date, so I have to look it up, but the girls hockey team is doing Pink the Rink again. I want to say it's a week from... No, I'm not going to say. But it should look up because it's a great way to come and support the girls' hockey team and also support a very important cause. Separately, I've attended a lot of meetings this week along with everyone else. I'm going to just, to your point, Board of Selectmen, Financial Forum, it's fascinating. I've learned so much over the past couple of weeks with all of the budget discussion. It's important to get our peers there because the more knowledge we have, the better we can all work together to make the tough decisions that we're going to have to do moving forward. I was really struck as a member of the school committee at the Board of Selectmen meeting talking about that, you know, they're wanting an additional SRO, school resource officer. We have one, Officer Mulo, who's outstanding, and a lot of his time is spent at the high school. We really need one to focus on the middle and the elementary schools. Mm-hmm. And that's just on the police department's wish list. I think that's a critical position. And that would be something that everyone, all of the schools would benefit from. So let's get out there, let's get informed, and let's see if we can work together.
Thank you.
I don't.
Linda.
I do. We had the Martin Luther King Day event on Monday. And so many people made that such a success. If you did not get to watch it, we have RCTV to thank because Mariah and Julia came out and taped it. So hopefully very soon it will be on broadcast on Channel 9, Comcast Channel 9, and Verizon Channel 31. And we will put the link up on the Human Relations Advisory Committee Facebook page and the website. And so please check it out. There were some amazing performances and a real strong message sent. I also wanted to just mention that I was able to attend Alice in Wonderland, the Coolidge play, and it was wonderful to see the magic that the students and the directors and the choreographers and everyone that they can create. And it's really a tribute to the town of Reading that we have not withdrawn from our arts commitment. I'm very proud to be a part of a school district in a town who values the arts, and we see the benefits of that every day. I know that a number of the kids that spoke were very active in a lot of the different arts programs, and it makes a huge difference. And I'm looking forward to real world problem solving tomorrow morning.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One item to add to Carl's, really, the boys swim team has their last dual home meet Saturday at 7 at the Burbank Y against Winchester. So I just want to know we had everybody's heading into state soon. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And there were no reports.
I do
over
not.
Here.
I do not have a report.
No report.
Martha, did you want to?
I have a presentation for you, though. And I would like to
and
first.
I should mention Joe's here.
Yes. Well, I was going to point out that Joe, Mr. Huggins, is in the audience. He's the director of facilities for the school and town. But before I delve into this, I do want to give a thank you to Sharon Angstrom, the town accountant, who spent considerable hours working with both Joe and I to really work. To make the town meeting vote of establishing that core department work within Munis. And it was a lot of work on her part. And the results are I was able to use Munis to create the budgets that we're going to walk through now. And Joe and I worked and developed these budgets collaboratively. So as you know, the school building maintenance, the major functions, and I've kind of delineated them between school buildings and town core. All of these previously were in the school building budget. The custodial staff, the custodian manager, the facilities rental coordinator, the supplies for the building, you know, the toilet paper, paper towels, you know, cleaning supplies. Contracted cleaning, as you're aware, we have contracted cleaning services both at the Coolidge Middle School and at the high school. And building security. All of those line items stayed with the school department budget. Everything that you see on the right has gone into the town core budget per the meeting at the town per the vote at the town meeting back in November. So the new assistant director position, the director, the maintenance staff, we have a licensed plumber, a licensed electrician, and a I don't want to misspeak what John Carter, is he a licensed maintenance man or
carpenter.
Licensed carpenter, thank you, a master carpenter, thank you, and the secretary that supports the department. Utility services, which includes all of our sewer, water, electric, natural gas, that's all gone into the town core, as well as the maintenance of buildings. So any extraordinary maintenance, preventative maintenance, all those things are now in the town core budget. And finally, extraordinary maintenance. As we've been talking about with every cost center, we have five goals that have been driving the decisions that we've been making to develop this budget. School security, improving safety and security is under goal number three. Creating the working group is under goal number four. So we just want to keep in mind that these five goals also help drive this budget development as well. The budget drivers. On the school side, the school building side, the custodial staff are under a contract, so there are step and salary increases. As Joe will talk about, we our cleaning contracts. This is the last year of our cleaning contracts, so there will be we do have anticipated increases in cost. We have increased the use of revolving fund offsets. I believe Dr. Doherty spoke about it earlier in the overview. We're going to take an offset from the extended day revolving fund of $90,000. That's the equivalent of 1 hour. For each school at the five elementary schools, an hour a day for the custodial support for our extended day program. I did have a thoughtful conversation with the town accountant, and this is something that is allowable. We can use this fund to help support the custodial expense. some decreases to the school building. When Sharon and I were meeting over the summer, we had to look at that $200,000 offset that comes from our facility rental account and say, where does it belong? Does it belong on the town or does it belong on the core? And when we did the analysis, taking into account, you know, really what our rental rates are and things along that lines, we split it $150,000 for school and $50,000 for the town core. And that had to do more with the custodial versus the electrical and natural gas, the utility, if you will. The $50,000 offset from extended day is really for facility rental, and we agreed that that would be allocated to the town core. On the town core side, the contractual increases were step and salary increases for our maintenance staff who are under a union contract, as well as other COLA increases. And Joe might want to talk a bit about this one. We did increase funding for HVAC preventative maintenance contracts. Our buildings are aging, and by doing more preventative maintenance, we will help extend the life and the good use of them.
We have a contract right now for HVAC that handles all the preventive maintenance for the general repairs of all the equipment, town and school side. And what Martha was talking about is for the controls that operate the buildings. A lot of the systems have come off their warranty period with our energy performance contracting initiative we did. So we need to maintain the stuff, and we need to get somebody here that can not only repair it when we need to repair, but also come in on a monthly basis and calibrate the system so that we're achieving our savings and we're, we're staying on top of it. So you can't just repair it, you have to maintain it at the same time. This goes along with the whole PM program we've implemented throughout the whole town of school building.
So, Martha.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's it.
So, I always ask this question. Well, do we really think 8% increase for contract cleaning? That's what I think is in there.
Yeah, it's in a future slide, but yeah, it is. That was based on
we have a really Joe's low cost we're paying right now. And from what we're seeing, because we just rebid our town cleaning contract, we're anticipating there's going to be an increase in the, and we're not really changing the scope, and we're not adding more hours. But we're seeing basically the industry that there's been an uptick. I mean, we have a really very, very low price right now for the square footage they're doing here at the high school. They do the night clean here at the high school, and they also, we have a full-time person that does night clean as part of that contract.
Mm-hmm. Give that to her.
Yes.
I guess I'm a little confused on the previous slide about the increase in the revolving fund offset of $90,000 and then a decrease of $50,000. So is that $40,000? Or is that in a different slide?
I'm so sorry, I didn't
repeat the question. The previous slide, so I'm a little confused by the increase in the revolving fund offset of $90,000
mm-hmm.
from the extended day, but then we have a decrease in $50,000 offset from the extended day, so they'll be allocated to town core. So does that mean that overall the extended day increases by $40,000 in this?
The $50,000 offset from extended day is going to town court. It's not eliminated. It's just not on our budget. It's not on the school budget anymore. So when you see the school budget, you'll see a combination of the $150,000 and the $90,000 from extended day. So we have a $240,000 offset in our budget for next year, which is a function of the $150,000 and the $90,000. So the 50 and the 50, if you look at the town core budget, there's a $100,000 offset on the town side. And it's those two combined, it's the 250s.
So, but are we saying if we didn't have the town core and we hadn't done this, we would have had that total, 200?
We would have had $100,000 more, yes.
Okay, in total offsets.
Correct.
So the $50,000 decrease is like from last year? Is that how I'm looking at those decreases?
FY16 has a $250,000 offset baked into the budget.
Mm-hmm.
When we had to separate the two and create a school and a town, we moved $100,000 to the town and kept $150,000 on the school.
And then we have an additional.
And now we have an additional 90 for FY17. Correct.
Okay.
No, that's okay. It's
And maybe it's in one of the, like, just laid out in the chart. I think this was just the thing that Mark was a little confused about last time.
I just wanted to continue. I was on the contract cleaning, and I don't want to I don't want to get down into the weeds with what you guys do. I'm just curious, and I don't know whether it's legal or not, but can we go to the existing contractor and say we'll extend it for a year for less than 8%? I mean, just seems to me to get an 8%.
The existing contract, we're going to want to probably go out to bid for performance reasons, I guess. I will tell you that depending on how we structure the bid package, we can do it. We can do qualifications based bidding on this, so we're not necessarily having to go with the lowest bid, but the best company to do the work. But we will make sure we have a good package put together with, you know, a good specification. The company that's doing the cleaning now is subcontracts another company to do it. It's almost like a franchise situation, and we're eliminating that because we want to have more control over the company. We want to talk directly to the owner. So that's the other reason we're bidding it out. And they're in their final year of the
We did exercise the third year. That's so this correct. Is the last year of the contract.
Yes. I have a quick one. The increased $90,000 in the offset, do you feel that that's sustainable over time?
Yes, we do.
Okay, thank you.
That was one of the questions the town accountant had for me as well.
I feel like I might ask it again tonight.
So the FTEs for the school building facility staffing has remained consistent. We still have the day and the night shift in our elementary, middle, and high school buildings. We have a 1.0 for the custodial manager, and the 0.4, that is part of the 0.6 facilities coordinator, rental coordinator. So the other 0.2 of that is charged directly to the school use revolving fund. When it comes to the categories, we have professional salaries, clerical, contractual services, supplies and materials. There's not a lot of money left in the school base because most of the larger ticket items have moved to the core. The contracted services, that is that's where you see the 8% that Mr. Robinson asked about. When you get into the actual detail, this is where Ms. Webb, where you asked about the 150. So it's 150 in this year's budget, increasing to 240 to next year for the offset. And that's a function of the additional offset from the extended day revolving fund to support custodial services. When it comes to the town core, I exported from Munis just what was school related, not town building related. So the jump in the professional salaries is, as you recall, back at the town meeting, they did vote to support the restoration of an assistant director position. I believe we had the position, I want to say 5 or 6 years ago was when it was eliminated, I think, due to turnover and the position just wasn't refilled.
Well, we had some budget cuts.
So, you know, the need was there and it was approved. So it's part of the FY17 budget. The secretary that was on the school budget is now part of the town core budget and is represented here. Other salaries represent the three licensed maintenance staff that we have. The contracted services that are here are what Joe spoke about with the preventative maintenance type of contracts, the Mason contracts, those type of things are what's captured here in the contracted services. There's very limited supplies and materials because most of the supplies and materials go to the upkeep of the school. So these would be supplies and materials that the maintenance staff would be using. And then other expenses is where we're capturing all of the utility costs, the water, the sewer, the extraordinary maintenance, things along those lines. And because this was such a long chart, I truncated and put it on two different slides. So here's a more granular level detail of the town core with the school detail. And I don't know if you have any specific questions about this that Joe or I might be able to answer for you.
So you're saying there's an equivalent, there would be an equivalent set of charts for town core, town detail? Like, so when you look at the town core, there's what the town has to support their buildings, basically these same expenses?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
My understanding, the way it's broken down in the new core budget is you have the school-based line items and the town-based line items.
Yeah, there's three separate. There's the core, which is, the, like Mark says, the maintenance and upkeep of all the buildings in that center with myself and the secretary, the assistant director, and the maintenance staff. And that's to maintain all town and school buildings. Then we have a school budget, which is the school custodians, the contract cleaning services, and the supplies associated with that. And then on the town side, a very similar situation, which is the town custodial staff and the cleaning contract for that side. And the brunt of it is in the core.
I presented it this way just because you're used to seeing the director and the professional salaries. That's all in the core. And so it's presented here as being part of the school core, but it's really the true core, if you will.
Trying to understand is this isn't a percentage, what we're looking at here isn't a percentage of, let's say, the professional salaries.
No, it's not. It's in total.
That this is in total.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Question. Going back to the previous slide, I'm a little confused about, there's contracted services under school buildings facilities budget by function, and that's the 8% that Mr. Robinson pointed out. And then on the next side, town core with school buildings only, contracted services is up 27%. And it looks to me like the 191,000 is part of the 254. I'm trying to connect those two lines.
They're two different things. The contracted services on the school only is our two cleaning contracts. That's it. These contracted services are what we were talking about earlier, the preventative maintenance contract on our HVAC.
Thank you.
Any contracted services that we may have for mason work, or electrical, roofs, yeah, all those contracts are what's captured in the 191.
Thank you very much.
You're essentially now seeing two separate budgets, whereas in previous years, it was all in one budget.
Yep. It's becoming clear.
So take, for example, under contracted services, alarm services at 11,000. Is that just for the school buildings, or is that for all the town, that's for all the buildings Joe manages?
This is just the school.
To school detail.
So I guess I'm just struggling. The salary lines are, is that a portion that's allocated to the school?
No, it's not. As I said earlier, I showed the salaries
100%. Okay, just the salaries.
Salaries are 100%.
Everything else?
Expenses are proportionate to the schools?
Are not proportionate. Our school expenses. So we kept the structure, the accounting structure. So the accounts that we used to use to charge HVAC still exist in Munis. It's just pointing to a core cost center now instead of to our school budget. So with the exception of the salary lines, which I showed in 100%, everything here is truly school building expenses.
So the salary lines are truly town core, and then the expense lines are the town core school detail.
Yes.
Okay, yep. Okay.
And I apologize for the confusion.
So, I mean, this is the first time, but I'm just trying to make sure that I'm understanding it. And I was just thinking, good for you, Joe. It wasn't.
So I mean, you all said.
Yeah, exactly.
So I had another question, and I don't want to, you know, show our cards, but I'm back to the contracted services again. Mm-hmm. Is now that's being bid, as you said. Within that process, do we consider whether or not we bring that back in-house or not?
We've done that. We've done that calculation before, and it's much more expensive to do it in-house. You'd be, even if you went with part-time people to get that cleaning done, it'd be, the rate that they're paying, number one, is lower, and we've got the benefit that we have to be concerned of in retirement. You'd really want to do it if you're going to do it in-house with full-time people. Managing a part-time staff would be more difficult. They do it part-time because they have supervision overseeing the contract at night. We don't have nighttime supervision in our buildings like that. We're not set up to do it. But comparatively speaking, it is much cheaper to go contract out. It lends itself to working here at the high school because we can clean it at night. You know, we've got our two full-time guys that work here. One works till 11 o'clock, one works till 8 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
If both our own people lock the building up and the cleaners can, you know, are while they're working in the building. We will make sure that we get as competitive a price as we can with a solid company.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not. It's always something.
No, we review this. Every couple of years we've had this conversation.
Thank you.
That was it for the presentation. On, are there any other school or town core facility questions? No. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
The next part of the presentation that we wanted to go through were our special revenue funds and our grant funds. And so our revenue funds, our federal grants that we receive, these are entitlement grants, our Title I, our Title IIA, our IDEA grant, which is our No Child Left Behind grant, special education, early childhood grant, school transformation, and the school transformation grant is not an entitlement grant. That's the grant that Sarah Bird wrote a few years ago. We're in our second year of that grant. And the mental health first aid grant is one that Erica McNamara secured for us a year ago, and we're in our second year of that grant as well. The school climate transformation grant is a 5-year grant, and the mental health first aid is a 2-year grant. It was the school climate transformation grant is about a little more than $250,000 a year over each year for 5 years, and the mental health first aid grant was $50,000 a year for 2 years.
And these are the ones that we reported out on last year, right? That we got right around
yes.
budget time.
Yes.
Exactly. Yes. The state grants that we have, METCO is a state grant that we have. We have currently, I believe, 72 students that come to the Reading Public Schools from the inner city of Boston. Our academic support grant is a smaller grant that helps with at the middle school level is where we primarily use it for MCAS study and prep. And the Circuit Breaker Award is another state grant that we get. When it comes to grant-funded positions, the bulk of the positions that are on this grid are teacher positions, and those are funded from our IDEA grant, which is our federal grant. We do carry a Title I coordinator. We also use our IDEA grant to fund some team chair positions in the special education department. The tutor line, those positions are Title I funded, and we typically don't put them in the budget for the next year because we don't know what the Title I award is going to be and necessarily how we're going to allocate or use those resources. The data analyst line, as you can see, it was really 0.25 last year. It rounded up to 3. So it was 0.25. That was funded from the school climate transformation grant where we were splitting a 1.0 person between the operating budget and the grant. It was always our intent to bring that person back to the operating budget based on the needs of where we found ourselves in year two. We wrote an adjustment to the grant or a modification to the grant, requested it, and received approval to hire a 1.0 FTE. So there's overlap this year. That's why you see a decline going into next year, because that 0.25, if you recall, that is coming back onto the budget in the technology cost center for next year. The special revenue funds are our revolving funds. We have a number that support the activities here in the school department. The school lunch program is a revolving fund that we have, our athletic revolving fund. Most of our revolving funds either have fees or charges, and the source of the fee and charges are what we need to use the funds for. So, for example, our athletic fund revolving fund we use to fund our coaches in our athletic budget. The revenue offset, so this chart is updated from what was in the budget book. The balances as of June 30th are on the far left. The projected balance for the end of this fiscal year is in the middle of the column. I have done my best to project what I think the revenue and expenses are going to be, and I've included what the budgeted offset is for FY16. As you can see with the athletic revolving fund, the budgeted offset for this year is $380,000, and the budgeted offset for next year is $396,000, almost $397,000. So at the end of FY17, that revolving fund will have under $10,000 in it. So this year's offset is going to, or the proposed offset for next year is going to really impact that revolving fund. The drama revolving fund is in better shape this year. The plays that the Mary Poppins play, the revenue from the Mary Poppins play has been very encouraging, and the plays that are scheduled for the rest of the year. So I feel comfortable with the $130,000 revenue forecast for the year for that one. There is a transposition error in my grid, I apologize. The budgeted offset for next year is actually $57,000, not 52. It's just a transfer. This is unfortunately one of the tables that I have to manually update, and I transpose the two numbers, so I will correct that for the budget book. The extended day, that is a revolving fund that we have been talking about, and we did report, Sharon Angstrom and I did report to the school committee back in October about four of our larger revolving funds. Extended day revenue has been growing and participation has been growing. The school committee did approve back in, I believe, early November, the addition of two positions. Those positions have been hired and have started, so we'll have a partial year of those salaries in FY16 and a full year in FY17. We'll also have a full, FY17 has the increase in the offset for the revolving fund, so that's where you see the $85,000 increasing to $195,000. That's the increase of the $90,000 offset for next year. We do anticipate that revolving fund starting to tick down, if you will, in terms of not growing anymore, if you will, because it has been growing year after year, and there's been a lot of question about it. Were we appropriately charging people? And it really, the charges that we were assessing for participation in extended day are fair and reasonable and appropriate. We haven't been supporting it in terms of having a billing coordinator, having a registrar, having that office support where the director, you know, when the director joined us, there were 167 participants. There's over 400 now. And she really didn't have any additional staff to help support the program. So we do feel that fund over time is going to correct itself. The preschool, the RISE preschool, is pretty consistent. We're anticipating the same offset for next year at $330,000. The use of school property is one that we are going to have to look at. That's one where we really have not done an analysis to see where our fees and our charges should be for renting our facilities. The coordinator and I have scheduled time to look at, and we will at a future date make a recommendation on what an increased fee may be, or an increased a new schedule of fees for FY17. Special education tuition fund, that's one that we reported on over the summer. Sharon Angstrom and I, back in October, the town accountant and I reviewed that one. The significant increase in offset this year was to help mitigate the loss of the circuit breaker support in FY16, and that one really was not sustainable. Based on our current enrollment, I estimate we're going to have about $175,000 of tuition revenue this year. Our tuitioned in students, I want to say it peaked a couple years ago at six, mm-hmm. six or seven. Mm-hmm. We're down to four now. We do have a potential another student coming in, which could help improve the revenue picture, but this, much like the out-of-district placement, is fragile, and it's really very unpredictable. we had a student who was tuitioned in last year who left the district in March for another placement. So this is one that it's not necessarily dependable or predictable revenue. And so the recommended offset for next year at $215,000 will leave about $215,000, which is another 1 year's worth of offset as the ending balance, which is what our recommendation is. The full day kindergarten, the revenue from this one has been pretty consistent the last few years. It's similar to some of the other ones, is dependent on the population. Some years we've had a spike in students that qualify for free and reduced, and that impacts our tuition revenue. We've also had some years where we've had a number of students who were enrolled in full day kindergarten based on IEP needs. And so there's no tuition charged if it's IEP driven. We are recommending that we increase the offset to $900,000 for next year. That's based on increased enrollment, but also the increased cost. If you recall back in October, we determined based on our calculations that it costs us about $960,000 to run that second half of the day. And but some of those kids are there because they're IEP driven to be there, and some of them are there free and reduced and aren't paying. So there is some obligation of the operating budget to cover some of those costs. But we feel the revolving fund can sustain or can absorb the $900,000 for next year. I don't know if you have any specific questions.
When was the last time we looked at RISE tuition?
We've not looked at RISE in about 5 years.
Well, we haven't increased it, but we did look.
Yeah, we did look at it and compare it to other.
We did that last year, and then as part of Sharon and my analysis to see, part of our analysis wasn't just to look at what the ending balance was, but it was to look at, are we charging appropriately and are we expending appropriately? And so the charges for our special education tuition, based on our analysis, we are charging appropriately. And our analysis on RISE, we are appropriately priced, and so.
If I can add a comment to this slide, I know there's been a lot of questions, and I'm sure we'll have more questions about these revolving accounts, and can we take more out to offset some of our cuts? You can always take more out. The caution that I give the committee is, you can see that in several cases we are now reaching some very dangerous levels that we're concerned about. Athletics, use of school property, and some others. And the number that you take out for this year's budget or next year's budget is the number you start with for FY18. So if that projected balance is low because we don't have enough students in those programs anymore, and we have a decrease, then that affects us in FY18 when we have a starting point for our offsets. Because the bottom line that you see there, that it's 2.268 is what we're taking out next year. I showed that slide last night also, that shows, you know, how much on top of the 40 million we're taking out. We're taking out an additional 2.2. When we start losing that base and we have to keep adding to it, that means that's the starting point. It's like free cash. You're using $2 million of free cash this year in the total budget for revenue. That's the starting point for next year. And if you cut below that, that means that there's less revenue for both town and school budgets. So it's a similar notion.
Martha, what was the other expense column in there?
There are things that we do charge directly to the revolving fund. So for example, if you look at extended day, all of her personnel and her staff, that's all charged directly to her revolving fund. Similarly with athletics, the other expenses in there are when you receive a donation and we go out and buy whatever it was donated from that. The check was deposited into the revolving fund. Subsequently, the expenses charged the revolving fund. So that's what you're seeing there.
So all the assistant coaches.
The coaching assistant, yeah.
Yeah.
The coaching assistants that are donation funded. Are in that 35.
Yep. Our revolving.
So those are big numbers, though. We should have some backup somewhere within our book, I guess.
Are you talking about the other expenses?
Yeah.
We do.
I do not.
I'm down the road, I think. That's, you know, those are, they're not pennies. That's a lot of money that people, I mean, it deserves an explanation as to what it is, I guess.
We don't develop budgets for our revolving funds this far ahead. I mean,
well, I think the easy explanation is that for like the extended day program, we don't have the extended day staff in our budget, our FY17 budget. It's not part of our budget. So it's in the, it's other expenses. So all of those after school and before school staff get charged to that account.
I would agree though, just the
doesn't even, it can be a narrative. It doesn't even have to be the individual just something.
So a breakdown of what is that 34,000 and what's that 57? Yep.
Okay.
Linda had a question.
So Dr. Daugherty, you did anticipate my question, and I know I've been asking a lot of questions about the offsets, and I hear you about needing enough to start with the following year. We don't want to get too low because that would be to the detriment of the program going forward. My question is about, I have two questions. The full day kindergarten tuition, we have been growing every year in the number of people that want to participate in full day kindergarten. So I would think that we could anticipate more tuition income depending on, we're limited on space, but depending on how many full day kindergarten students we can still keep accepting into the program if we go above 70,000. So those additional people will be paying tuition, which would increase the revolving fund amount. I think I'm understanding, right?
I'm sorry, continue.
So part of my question is, if my assumption is right, that would be sort of a reliable income for that revolving account. I know that we cover some of the expenses of the buildings because they are part of each elementary school that they're in, the full-day kindergarten. And in a previous report, we were told that the nurses were not covered in offsets. So I was wondering if under full day kindergarten, whether some of that offset money, the revolving fund money, covers some of the nursing expenses of the schools that they are in.
So the revolving, so the tuition of $4,200 is calculated based on a percentage of the principal's time, a percentage of the nurse's time. It's based on enrollment. Yep. So that's the tuition. It's in the tuition, it's in the revenue number. We take the entire offset against our professional salary, against our teacher line. So I'm not sure that answers your question.
It does answer my question, okay. Because you do consider it, but instead of adding that in.
It's part of the formula when you come up with the 4,200.
When you come up with the tuition, it is part of the formula.
If I could add to, so what you see in the projected balance is just what it means, projected. So let me give you an example, is that right now, our kindergarten numbers are lower this year than they were last year. Not the total kindergarten population, which means we're also going to have less kids in full-day kindergarten. We also don't know at this time who is going to be requesting some tuition relief because they're on free and reduced lunch. Those things affect this number that we can't capture right now.
Even though there's increased
because
interest.
We're developing a budget now when we don't know yet. Registrations are still happening.
So my second, thank you, that does actually address
good.
My question.
Thanks.
And I didn't mean to sound redundant.
Oh, no, not at all.
Just trying to tease it apart. So my other question is about the use of school property. We have a new performance space or meeting space that's going to be opening up in town at the library, at the new library. And at the presentation at the selectmen's meeting, the library was talking about their policy about not charging for their presentation space. And I was wondering if how that's going to figure into our, the hiring of our, the renting of our space, whether we're talking to the library about how that's going to work and whether when you talk to Mr. McDonald, whether that's going to be part of what you're considering.
We don't have anything to do with the library space.
No, we don't, but that's going to be another space in town that's available as opposed to, or in addition to, what is rented here. And I'm wondering if that is going to kick our revolving, our rentals down a little bit, because if they can arrange space there.
No, the primary spaces that we rent here are gymnasiums, our performing arts centers. We do rent our cafeterias from time to time.
Fields, right.
The fields.
Yeah.
Turf.
The presentation space at the library, if someone was, I mean, it isn't a very high cost here. It's not going to have an impact.
Okay.
If someone were to rent a similar space here, like the multipurpose room or coolers or something like that.
And then I had one more that just goes back one slide,
mm-hmm.
where you talked about the grant, the state grants that we get.
Mm-hmm.
One of them being the Metco grant. And I just wanted to encourage people not to take the state money, for instance, for Metco for granted, because every year the state puts that on the chopping block.
Mm-hmm.
It comes spring. And there's an opportunity in March to go and speak out to the state to justify the funds that we get for the Metco program, to support the Metco program here in town and the benefits for both those students that are investing so much time and energy to get here and for our students to have them here.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'd just like to invite people and raise some interest. I go every year. I'm going again. I'd love to fill my car with people that want to go with me, just to make a statement and make sure that those funds that we get for the Metco program aren't in jeopardy. So thank you.
Thank you.
I had a question about the athletic fee. I'm trying to square up in the budget book. You have all the revolving funds listed. And in this, it's just ones we offset it, right?
Correct.
So what I was kind of looking at for each fund was revenues versus expenditures. How close are they, right? And in the athletic fee one, it's like in the neighborhood. The expenditures outpaced revenues a bit, but it's a healthy balance, so it's okay. But when I look at the one in this presentation, I'm trying to make sense of, are expenditures the same thing as other expenses?
Expenditures are the combination of the two. So I didn't break out offsets.
Okay. The offset includes expenditures.
I for illustrative purposes, I heard people wanted to see the offset, so this teases out the offset.
So to Dr. Doherty's point, I have kind of a concern on both sides. So on the athletic activities, we end with a balance in 2 years of $7,000.
Mm-hmm.
That's a structural deficit, right? So in FY18, we're looking at having to fill a $300,000. I just want to make sure I understand.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's obviously a concern. smaller question on drama activities. There's a projected decrease of $20,000 in revenue in FY17. And
this
I saw Mary Poppins, and I expect revenue to go up.
FY17 is next year. They haven't announced the plays.
they're going to be awesome.
If you look at, to your point, revenue this year was $94,000. So the actual revenue in FY15 was $94,000. So $130,000 next year is actually quite a, this current year is actually quite a spike due to the overwhelming popularity of Mary Poppins.
Okay.
So to adjust it back down to 110 is really pretty, almost pretty aggressive given that it was 94,000 in FY15.
Okay.
So
I think I might push back a very, very little bit, not too much, but where the balance goes up by $500, year over year, maybe pull a little bit more out of that. So at least we're not increasing the balance from 36,000 in FY16 to 36,500. It's a very small number, but.
Okay.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, again, the projected balance is an estimate. I mean, in it, it also depends on, students that participate.
Sure.
And so if we have less students participating in a show, that affects it as well. So again, estimate.
Right.
That's not
okay.
That's not a known number.
So
that last column
be,
is not a known number
right
now.
The swing will be thousands either way.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think, let me think about that for a little bit. I think I'm good for now.
I just had a quick follow-up on Linda's comment about the rental space, and actually, the Board of Selectmen suggested to the library trustees that the school model was something that they should consider, because they said the schools did this really well, and they should come to us and find out, figure out how we charge for our space, so that maybe they could consider doing the same for the library.
Thank you. I appreciate that, because, you know, Stephen McDonald has been a great asset to the district in terms of managing it, monitoring it, billing it in a timely manner, collecting it in a timely manner. Really, just having that 0.6 dedicated resource has really helped us. And I know there was a question earlier during the public input, and we'll get back to it, but anecdotally, I think that you will see that our revenue has increased over time by having a dedicated asset, a dedicated person managing it, but I'll have to go back and look at the numbers.
No, I think it's true, because anecdotally, the bill collecting is always a challenge when you don't have someone that's focused on doing that.
Yeah.
So I wasn't at that meeting, but I guess what I'm hearing is the library's proposing that we're going to be competing against Free Space. Is that?
I don't know. I wasn't there.
They talked about their policy being not to charge for their space because it is a public space. But the selectmen recommended that they go back and think about what falls within that jurisdiction and what they might, for practical purposes, need to think about what.
Yeah. And Sharon, the town accountant, cautioned that there are restrictions around what they would be able to charge and how they could calculate what they could charge in order not to put bonds at risk. More than it costs to make the space available.
Like utilities and things like
exactly.
That.
Yeah.
Do you have something?
I did have another question, just a clarification too. In terms of the projected revenues for the drama, we were talking a little bit, and we're, when we have a play, when the drama program has a play like Mary Poppins or like a Disney that's very popular and draws from K through 95-year-olds, kindergarten through 95-year-olds, and they sell out, that's one thing, but the possible revenues are not how the plays are chosen. So not every year do they choose a blockbuster like Mary Poppins, because the goal of the drama program is to give students an opportunity to learn both through the play, through the subject matter, and I'm racking my brain for the one, forgive me, I'm going to say, It's a Privilege to Pee. What
You're in town.
You're in town.
You're in town. Thank you. And so
which
they
was
choose,
not a blockbuster.
No,
it wasn't.
But it was an excellent play.
An excellent play and a learning experience for the students, and that was a priority as well as, or even more so than the revenue that it would necessarily bring in. And some of those plays don't necessarily cater to the younger audiences, but that is the teachers and the directors know best about what they're trying to teach their students at what time. And so we can't always count on a Mary Poppins that's going to fill six performances. And so the revenues might change.
If I can also add to that, which I thought this is where you were going, but I'm glad you brought it up, is that with a popular play like Mary Poppins comes a large royalty that you have to pay out.
Yeah.
So you may have filled the auditorium, but you're also paying out a very large royalty.
Sorry, didn't get there.
That was something else in our budget. So, yeah. We've already seen that royalty number.
So just to, I think Jean brought it up, but and I've been looking at it all, you know, as been going through the budget. I'm concerned about the athletic, what's going to be left. And I know when we use revolving funds, we always assure everybody that we're going to be at a level that we're still safe. Well, how the heck did we get to 7,400 before we realize it? I mean, that seems like, I mean, wouldn't we have known about that last year when we used some of those revolving funds?
Certainly the projections that we did last year were somewhat challenging because there was with an increased user fee, and now that we have the the increased fee this year, so I was projecting, not knowing participation, with a new user fee structure and a new cap structure, both for individual and a family, and, you know, early evidence from fall and winter sports, our participation has not declined significantly. I haven't had a lot of visibility on people reaching the cap yet because they wouldn't have hit it yet with two sports. They'll hit it in the spring. So I'm not sure what the visibility is going to be in terms of, you know, when I modeled it, I assumed a certain percentage would hit a cap, but I haven't had a chance to see if my model was correct yet. So some of this is conservative. I think, you know, I think we did say last year that we weren't sure how sustainable these offsets were over time.
But we always make that assurance when we vote the budget that it's going to be sustainable, and that's not.
So I again, mean, that's a projected FY, that's a June 30th of 2017 number.
Right.
So I think the one we want to focus on is the 16 number, and we can check that at the end of this year to see if we're on track. If not, we'll have to make some adjustments as to what we take out from what we've budgeted. So we'll just have to look at that carefully and adjust it accordingly.
Yes.
Along these lines, I know it's been, you know, a few weeks, so some of these projections, I think, that were in the budget book are a little different. So I assume these ones that you've done are sort of like more accurate. You've taken
Thank you. The table that's in the budget book is incorrect. There's a formula error in it. So this is the corrected table, and
okay.
the revised one will be in the next version.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I just wanted, because that projection was a little higher on the athletics there. Well, not a little, 30,000, sort of not a little, but. Yeah, and I guess I also appreciate, in this package, right, you also sort of listed the donations. I just have, you know, some concerns about how tightly we're running that, and knowing that, you know, there's a lot of money that's going into donations that supports, you know, some other aspects of not just the athletics, but other programs. And we're running that really close.
I do. I'm actually, I feel like our town manager. I'm having a philosophical question. on the one hand, I'm concerned about the sustainability of the athletic activities fee. On the other hand, I think the environment we find ourselves in is changing. So we heard last night more aggressive talk about a potential override in the fall. And this is really a question I'm throwing out there for the administration and the committee to grapple with before Monday when we start deliberations properly. Is this an environment, given that we are looking like voters are going to have an opportunity to weigh in, where we can be a little more aggressive in taking these offsets to protect the parent who spoke during public comments spoke very eloquently about protect teachers, whatever you do, protect teachers. Is there, and I know we're very limited in how we can use these funds, but is this a moment where slightly more aggressive use of the funds for one more year until the voters have an opportunity to weigh in could protect some positions? And I don't even know how I feel about that. I just think that the environment is different than it was a year ago. And that could impact our use of these offsets. Is that a discussion you had at all that weighed into how you decided to?
We've had a lot of discussion about this. And again, that's why I said at the beginning what I said.
Yeah.
I caution you that if an override does not pass, that you what you start with is the amount you've taken out. And if we then don't have a sustainable amount in the projected balance, then
yep.
that means that we're making those cuts on top of the cuts we're going to already have to make on a 1% budget.
Yep.
So we did take a good look at that.
And the flip side of that argument is if an override does pass, we were able to protect those positions. So it's...
I know, but I have to assume right now that...
It doesn't.
I can't assume that we're going to have an
yep.
override.
Yep, I know.
And we did, that's why we took additional funds out. If you'll notice, when we went forward to you with the reductions, we increased our offsets.
Yeah. I have one more quick, it's a request of Martha. I spent a lot of time on these two pages in the budget book. So it's figure 113 and figure 114.
Mm-hmm.
And one is all the revolving funds with the balance, expenditures, revenues, and balance, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then on the next page, you pull out the offset ones and go into more detail. Would it be possible to get that figure with all the revolving accounts? I understand that it's like under offset, it's going to say zero. But I found myself flipping back and forth a lot. Would that be an easy.
I'm not sure I understand what you want to see.
So you see on figure 114, I don't know if you have your, the chart you're looking at. So that's only the revenue offset summary.
Yep.
And you project out through FY 17. On the previous one is only through FY 15. And I would love to see projections for all these other revenue funds. If it's not possible, then okay.
This is,
there we go.
This is a,
it's a recommendation
process.
It's a recommendation for the future because I'm interested in the bottom line number. And the new handout you gave us today, you're seeing the numbers go down, right? So 2.8 to the bottom line number, and that's what we want to see. We want to see that number coming down. It would just be interesting to include all the other funds, which are smaller in balance. So maybe next year. Thank you.
Is that the last slide on that?
That is the last part of the presentation. There are some additional information that we wanted to provide.
Well, that's probably something now we'll do Monday night as a context to the quest before the questions.
Oh, yeah.
Does anyone have L7 questions? Anyone from the public? Thank you.
Email me your other questions. I haven't heard from the chair yet, and Elaine, and so please email them as soon as possible, so I can get to work on them and have them ready for Monday night.
Did you have?
Unless I missed something, did you approve the consent agenda?
We're gonna do that
okay.
Right.
I didn't know if I was.
I did miss it, and I just saw it.
La La Land, or if I.
Shelley, move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Well, does anybody have anything they'd like to take off the consent agenda? No.
Right now I will. Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second? All those in favor? 5-0. I believe that's.
Is there anything in particular for Monday night?
Yes.
So, almost, I think all of the tables.
There's a couple that we've shown you here that weren't.
Yeah. Okay, so I just want to make sure, but for the most part.
Yeah. Yes.
And just anecdotally, Mrs. Borowski has sent her questions to me, and I have started embedding other tables that illustrate, and she requested a different view on some of them, so those are embedded in the questions. So my goal is to have that as a handout. Hopefully it can go out before Monday night's meeting, but if there's another way that you want to look at the data or have a question about specific things, I'm happy to drill down deeper if that's what you want.
I'll talk to you outside.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Mrs. Borowski asked a lot of questions, so thank you. You mentioned, and I noticed it, that the handout today, there was a calculation error, and the numbers weren't the same. Mm-hmm. Is that true on all of them?
Nope.
Or just the offsets?
Just the one that I tried to project. The one that's in there, the
figure 113.
Figure 113 is the ending balances as of June 30th, 2015.
So everyone on this page is still accurate?
That page is fine.
Okay.
It was a formula error in the forecasting table that I tried to create that had a few bumps in it. So
thank
I apologize
you.
For
no,
that.
No, no, thank you.
So back.
I was just, so
that figure
one,
is fine.
This is fine.
That is accurate, yeah.
Thank you.
So
that's the one that I've updated.
So back to Dr. Daugherty's question. I think that, does anyone have anything? Go ahead.
No, I just want to make sure we have the information that you need so that you can vote on Monday night. That's why I'm asking the question.
Yes.
No, I think it's a question for Monday night that I'll send ahead. It's something that evolved out of tonight.
Okay.
That I think
we're good.
Okay.
The goal is to vote Monday night, but we do have Thursday held in case, but...
Yeah, we've not posted that yet, but...
Oh, I thought we were.
No, we haven't posted it yet, but we can.
Yeah.
If we need to.
Move to adjourn?
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you to the public and everyone that came, the staff that came.
Thank you.